Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
We are a blessed people because, as we saw last week, we have a great high priest. But what does that mean? How should we understand that fact that Yeshua, that is Jesus of Nazareth, that he is our high priest? Well, that's exactly what we're going to see the writer of Hebrews reveal to us in this week's study. So take out your Bible and look with me to the book of Hebrews and chapter 5. The book of Hebrews and chapter 5. Now, we're going to learn today and in the weeks to come truly what it means that Yeshua is a great high priest. What are the implications for us in this age? And what are the eternal outcome of the fact that we have a high priest who passed through the heavens, who came into this world, who offered up himself once and sufficiently for our sins, bringing about, and here's the key, an eternal redemption and therefore an eternal relationship with the living God. Well, look with me to verse 1. The book of Hebrews, chapter 5, and verse 1. He's going to begin to lay a foundation, speaking about typical priests. So he says here in verse 1, "For every high priest from men is taken." So we have a connection between the high priests that served previously in the temple and Messiah. What do they have in common? Well, they are fully men. But there is a shortage with the humanity. You see, Messiah being fully man, but he's also, as we saw last week, one who passed through the heavens. And therefore, we're going to see that we are a recipient of a better priesthood, one who can bring about eternal outcomes. So once again, for every high priest from men are taken, and behalf of men they are appointed. So they serve in behalf of men, but notice what it says, for the service unto God. Now here, the word that I translated service is really just one Hebrew or Greek word, and it's the definite article, the. In the biblical language, we can have the word the in the plural. So it's speaking about those things which they are appointed to do in behalf of men, but to God. And what is that? Well, we're going to learn that if we're talking about a priesthood, all priests have something in common. And that is they have a particular service, something that they are supposed to bring about and deal with. And what is that? Well, as we keep reading, it says here, in order to offer up gifts or offerings and also sacrifices, and here's the key, in behalf of sin. Whenever we deal with this concept of a priest, the main responsibility, the priority of his ministry is to deal with the problem of sin. And we're going to see that typical priests, that is, those who were of the tribe of Levite and from the household of Aaron, although they did their work was insufficient. It did not have eternal implications. So why did God bring it about? Why did he appoint these high priests? Here's the key. So that we can better understand the work of Messiah. We're going to learn later on in our study that these priests, they were a pattern of that which were to come. And there's a basis previously for understanding their ministry, and there's a perfect expression after the fact, that is, after the giving of the law, through the ministry of our high priest, Yeshua. Yeshua from Nazareth, that is Jesus from Nazareth. So we look here and we find that they are appointed, they're taken from humanity, that is from the house of Levi, from the family of Aaron, and they are appointed from men and for men for the service to God, but here's the key, in behalf of sin. Now, because they're humans, they can understand the frailties of other humans. And that's why when we move on to verse 2, we see the first thing that is mentioned here is the fact that they can show compassion. Why? Because they also struggle with sin. They know human frailty. They know the power of what Judaism calls Yetzer Hara, that evil inclination. We would call it the carnal nature or the sin nature. So it says here that they are able to show compassion. They're able literally to measure the feelings. Now, what do we mean measuring the feelings? Well, they're going to be speaking here. If you look on into verse 2, there are two terms that are given. Now, usually in English, we talk about those who are ignorant or unaware, but if we understand the Torah, and I'm speaking about the book of Leviticus primarily, there we find that there are different types of sins which are mentioned. There are sins known by the Hebrew word bishgaga. Now, bishgaga is a sin, but it's an unintentional sin. That is, the person did not intend to do it, or perhaps he did not know such behavior was a violation. And even though he has ignorance, he is unaware of that, that does not mean that he doesn't suffer the consequences, that there's no punishment. There are punishment. There are implications to when we disobey the word of God, whether we do it with intent or, as it says here, bishgaga, without intent. So these priests know that sometimes a person sins, but he didn't mean to sin, but he's suffering the consequences of that. And then it moves on, those who do so, and here it is. This word means with deceit. Now, in the Hebrew, we have the word mazid. Now, this is Greek. But the parallel, the foundation for understanding that is what we learn in the Old Testament, in the Pentateuch, more precisely, what we call the Torah or the law, for those sins which are done by mazid. That is, they knew it was wrong. They were convicted by God that such behavior, such actions are displeasing to him. They're sinful and they're going to bring about his condemnation, but nevertheless, because, remember the context, because of human frailty, because of our weakness, because of the fact that we are carnal beings with that evil inclination, sometimes we simply rebel against God, and once again, there are implications. Usually, the implications and the outcomes, the punishments for willful sin, are greater than those that we do, bishgaga, by accident or without intent. So what the scripture is saying is this, that the normal priests that serve, because they're human beings, remember what we learned, they're taken from men, they are appointed by God, but they are human beings, they understand these things, they can have compassion and show sympathy, because they too, look at the middle of verse 2, since also he, meaning the high priest, a typical one, they are saddled by weaknesses. Now, verse 3. And on account of these things, he ought to offer up, just as concerning the people are sinful, but so is he. Thus also concerning himself, that he ought to offer up, what does it say once again, in behalf of sin. So when we look at the end of verse 1 and the end of verse 3, we see something consistent. What is that? Well, what we see is there's a problem of sin. And because of this problem of sin, priests were appointed to deal with that, to deal with the offense. To do what? Well, we've already talked about. To offer up offerings and sacrifices in order to deal with this problem. But here's what we're going to learn. We're going to learn in the weeks to come, and it's going to be repeated over and over because it is an important biblical truth. The priesthood, the high priests, they had to do their work continuously. Why? Because what they were able to receive or bring about through their offering, it was not eternally sufficient. They had to do it daily, yearly, because what they could bring about was only a covering of sin, what the Bible calls an atonement. But we're going to see that Messiah, he is superior. We're going to learn that what he brings about is not just a covering of sin, so it keeps God's judgment at a distance, but Messiah is going to purchase for us eternal redemption. He's not going to cover sin, but he's going to wipe away sin so it does not remain. And his work, and this is going to be proclaimed loudly, his work has eternal implications, and that's so vital. Messiah's work is all sufficient for how long? For eternity. Meaning this, the work that he did brings about an outcome that cannot be changed or altered by anyone, because there is a supernatural, a heavenly power that the normal high priests under the family of Aaron from the tribe of Levites, they could not bring about. Now move on to verse 4. It says here that none of these ones, meaning the high priest, it says he does not take of himself this honor. So he doesn't volunteer for it. He doesn't apply for it. No, it says here, but one is called by God, just as also Aaron. So the foundation of the high priest was Aaron. He was the first one. He didn't volunteer. In fact, he knew nothing of a priesthood. But nevertheless, God, through divine revelation, God called Aaron, and he calls other into this position. So we don't volunteer, we don't grasp it, it says, but rather one is appointed, it uses the phrase here, one is called by God. Now look at verse 5. Thus also, now see what it's doing? In this passage of Scripture, it's laying a foundation which we can be assured of because it's established in the law. Now, when I say law, what I'm speaking about is Scripture. When I mention the law, or the Hebrew word which means law, the Torah, I'm talking about the first five books in the Bible: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. We have a scriptural foundation that is set forth, and here's something that we're going to see over and over being emphasized, and that is this. It is through that foundation of the law what is revealed. Now, the law, we have to understand it in two ways. They're not at odds with one another. They're not contradictive. But what we find here is this. Many times when someone mentions the law, what they're speaking about are biblical commandments alone. How many are there? Well, 613 biblical commandments in those five books. But the law, those five books are not just about commandments, but also we have accounts, we have stories, we have history, we have events being shared with us. So the law, one sense we can say, oh, it's commandments, that is, but it's also historical biblical accounts of individuals, of families, of happenings, events which took place. And what do we glean from that? Well, the law gives to us a framework. It gives to us a foundation for understanding greater revelation. Here's what I want you to see, and we're going to underscore this in the weeks to come, especially when we get into chapter 7, because there's a very, very important word that's usually mistranslated. It is not understood. But this word has to do with putting two things side by side. And why is that? Well, when you lay one thing down and you have an understanding of that, That one thing can provide a basis, a framework for understanding something which is new. Something which, if it just came without this framework, without a pattern, without a diagram or a previous example, we might not be able to understand it. So in the scripture, the writer of Hebrews, he's constantly saying, here's what we learned in the books of Exodus or Leviticus or Deuteronomy. This is what we learn, and therefore it helps us to be able to perceive in a more excellent way what God is revealing about Messiah. Remember how we began 2 months ago. We said that the primary objective of the writer of Hebrews, and no one knows who it is that we might understand the person of Messiah, that is his identity, who he is, and also the work of Messiah. What did Yeshua do? What is the outcome, the implications of his ministry that he has done in our behalf? Just like all priests serve in behalf of men, but unto God, those things which are served unto God. That's what a priest does. We need to understand them for Yeshua. And the framework for understanding these things in a clearer, in a factual, according to truth, is what we learn in the Torah. And that's why when people don't study the Old Testament, they think it's something of the past. The problem with that is this. It is the Old Testament that gives us, so to speak, the proper lenses for understanding the New Testament. That's what this writer is trying to share with us, and he's going to do so over and over. So look now, we find in verse 5, thus also, meaning in the same way that we find the paradigm for the priesthood being called by God, we find that Messiah, he did not take this glory and became high priest of his own initiative, but rather, it says, but the one who spoke to him. And once again, where is this scripture going? Well, where it goes frequently. We find consistently in the book of Hebrews and really all throughout the New Testament. What the writers of the New Testament do is this. They constantly reveal revelation to us, what God has through the Holy Spirit given them to write down. But they give us the basis, the foundation of that through the Old Testament. So Messiah, he did not choose of himself to be the high priest, but rather the word of God confirms him. Where? Well, I'm talking about Psalm 2 and verse 7 where it says, and God is speaking and he says, you are my son, but the language here says literally, my son are you. This my son is being emphasized. So my son are you, I today. And this is an important word. The word today in the biblical language speaks of opportunity. So ever since this was proclaimed, there's an opportunity for who? For you and for me. That we might respond to what God is revealing. The fact that Yeshua is his son. So once more, we read here in verse 5 at the end. My son are you, I today have beget you. That is, Messiah was born into this world. And here's a problem. Many people, and I believe we talked about this previously, but it does us well to repeat ourselves sometimes and underscore it and emphasize it. A birth does not reveal something that is new, meaning at the birth, he was created. That's not what birth is about. Birth, that word, has to do with a disclosure. That child was the same, had those 5 fingers on each hand, 10 toes in total. He was just like he was the moment before he was born, as he is after. It's simply that there's a manifestation, a revealing, an appearance, a disclosure. So what the scripture means when it says, today I have beget you, meaning simply, today I have revealed you. I have disclosed you as my son. And son, biblically speaking, there's a couple different definitions of that word son. One is servant. So today, Yeshua, in this context, is the one who's going to serve his Father for the purpose of dealing with sin. Why? Well, the context here is he's being called to be high priest. And what does every priest deal with? The answer is sin. They have to solve the problem of sin. The old covenant high priests, well, they could only keep God's judgment, his punishments for sin, at a distance. But they did not remove the need for God's judgment. It was simply holding it at bay, pushing it back for a limited period of time. But the sin was still there. This is not the case with Messiah Yeshua. He, through his perfect priesthood, through his all-sufficient work, he is going to remove the need for God's judgment. And he is going to bring about a new condition for those who receive his priesthood. Therefore, move on to verse 6, just as also in another place. And when it says here, this phrase, in another place, it's speaking about another scripture where it says, you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. That is Melchizedek. Now, we're going to see how important this order of Melchizedek is. We read about him in the book of Genesis, and we'll talk more about him. But let me simply say that the key thought here is this term Melchizedek. See, many people hear that, and they think, well, that's just a name. But names in the Bible have meanings. And we're going to find it's not just a name, but it is a title. That term, Melchizedek, or Melchizedek, it means my king of righteousness. Now, there's a connection always between the word righteousness and the kingdom. So right there, if we have a good understanding of biblical truth, we're going to be aware of the fact that Melchizedek, this priest, he is going to have kingdom implications, meaning this. He is going to teach us principles of the kingdom. He is a forerunner. Here's what we learn. He appears, for example, primarily, and we're going to see this, he comes and meets Abraham. We'll talk more about that in a moment, but let me simply say this. He comes and meets Abraham during a very significant time, a time of victory. And therefore, it is what we learn about that event, his meeting with Abraham, and what Abraham does to him. What the scripture reveals in Genesis gives us a better understanding of Yeshua. That is what Jesus has done, the implications of his ministry. So if you don't know and rightly understand Melchizedek, you cannot understand to the fullness what God would have you to understand, what God wants you to understand, and what you need to understand about Yeshua. Your faith is going to be insufficient. See, most people do not know that Melchizedek is my king of righteousness. So what is the purpose of Messiah's ministry? Well, it's not just that we might find redemption for our sins. That's part of it, and that's a big blessing. That is a wonderful instrument of grace. But here's the key. It has an outcome to it, and what is that? That righteousness might be mediated to us, and here's the key, through our lives to others, that we might be ambassadors of righteousness. Let me tell you, there is a strong connection between righteousness and our call in this world, in this flesh as believers, being made a new creation through the ministry of Yeshua. So we read here that you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek, who in the days of his flesh, now it's speaking about Messiah, speaking about that he's of the order of Melchizedek, but we're speaking about Messiah, who prayed and also supplicated to the one who is able to save him from death with a strong proclamation and with the bringing forth of tears, and he was heard by his piety. Now, remember the key. We're talking about righteousness. And Messiah's work brought about righteousness. What work? His work on the cross. And this account of him praying and making supplications and with a strong proclamation, bringing forth tears to the one who was able to save him. What is that referring to? Well, if you check the Christian commentators, the vast majority of them, and I agree, speak of Yeshua while he was in the Garden of Gethsemane. And what did God do? Well, he heard, he could have saved him, meaning he could have removed him from that act of having to suffer and be killed and die. But he didn't. What took place there? What happened? Well, the purpose is, and don't forget this, righteousness. And righteousness, his righteousness was never in question, but our righteousness was. And it's only through his act of obedience that you and I could become righteous individuals in God's sight, not by our deeds, but by the sufficiency of Messiah's work upon the cross. So he interceded with prayers and supplications, and the one who could save him heard him by his piety, and that's what it says here. And though being a son, now he's the Son of God, and son has an idea of preference. But notice what it says. Although he was a son, he learned from suffering obedience and was complete, perfect. Now, he never wasn't perfect, but he demonstrated perfection, being given a power from his heavenly Father, because he was human but also the Son of God. But it was hard for him to go to the cross. So he prayed and he received power. And that demonstrated his perfection. And he also becomes the cause for those who are hearing him, all those who are hearing him, the cause of, here it says, eternal salvation. Isn't that great? That through his work we have, and what does it say? Don't miss it. It says eternal salvation. And that concept is going to be so important in the weeks to come when we learn more about Messiah's ministry, that he purchased for us through his perfect priesthood eternal salvation. And if we don't understand eternal salvation, we don't understand what Messiah has done. Well, I need to stop there. Until next week, may God richly bless you.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with him. Shalom from Israel.